dimension of all our actions. It's not accidental that the hero of revolution became Che Guevara, yeah, who actually was absolute failure in any respect. Yeah, he couldn't control Cuba after Communist Party took power, and all his revolutionary failed. So why the failure makes a hero? Yeah? Because the success is possible or not. Success is not enough a reason to act, actually. Because if you want success, then you become be very skeptical about any movements to act. So what can move you to act is not success, but precisely a certain lifestyle if you want. So if you want a certain life, for example, a revolutionary life, for example, life an artist and so on, so on, also under the presupposition that it fails, yeah, then you begin to act really. So people begin to act only if they accept and internalize the failure as the ultimate possibility of their action. And actually, it is precisely what a modern and contemporary theory and art also try to teach us, to accept the possibility of failure as ultimate possibility of action. Now, coming maybe back at the end of my presentation to the, I also already evoked this initial call by Christianity that founded European culture as we know it, call to convert, yeah, to go into the other world, to change your life, to change your mentality, and so on and so on. And there was a very famous description of this call by Soren Kirkegaard, you probably know that, contemporary of Karl Marx, actually, and also somebody from the post-Hegelian philosophical circle. Kirkegaard says, why this Christian call is really so interesting, and why the Christian call is so different for everybody else? Why Christianity, from his point of view, is different from all other religion? He said, because the figure of Christ is a very ordinary, everyday figure. Christ has no wings, yeah, he has no incredible possibilities in his body. He is not exceptional. He is not like a pagan god, yeah, before coming of Christianity. He is absolutely ordinary human figure. And to accept that this human figure can be good, that we can ascribe these divine possibilities to the ordinary human figure, is to overcome our deep distrust. So the religion of Christianity is a religion of deep distrust. It begins with a complete distrust into the figure of Christ. Now, in a very traditional manner, Kierkegaard says, and then it is quoted by many authors, including Derrida and many others, that we have to overcome this distrust. We have to overcome this distrust by leap of faith. Yeah, this very famous leap of faith that everybody quotes at a certain point in time from Derrida to Agamben and further. But if you look more attentively on the text of Kierkegaard, he says actually that we have to be Christian not because, not in spite of this deep distrust, yeah, that we have towards the figure of the Savior, but because of that. Yeah? Because if we would not have this distrust, yeah, we would simply seduced by a certain divine image or overwhelmed by it. So we would not have this kind of freedom to go our own way, certain kind of control on our own commitment to what we are actually doing. On the other hand, to accept Christianity is as improbable as to reject it. So if we have no base and no reason to accept it, we have also no reason to reject it. Yeah? So we are in a situation of complete freedom, and we are in a situation of complete distrust, and we have to look to that situation of complete distrust. So if we find the most total distrust, not that we discover some trust and begin to be utopian again and so on and so on. We have to go where the distrust is deeper and more radical, because that is a place where our freedom can be committed to. So if we look at our political system, and I really end with that because my time is also at the end. You know, there's a lot of talk of capitalism, yeah? And capitalism. I was in Ljubljana, yeah, the kind of conference, and everybody spoken about capitalism, what's capitalism. And what kind of surprised me in a certain way, I think the vocabulary has changed here a bit, but still people speak about, or they tend to speak about capitalism, even there's certain changes always there, in terms of system, structure, empire, yeah, or whatever. So in terms of something stable, or certain status quo that should be overcome, that should be changed, that should be discarded, that should be revolutionary, thrown away, and so on. So capitalism is something stable. I think also if you look at French philosophy as it heavily influenced contemporary thinking from Althusser and Foucault up to Deleuze and Derrida, you find time and again this opposition. On the one hand, as on the one side, you have something like a status quo, structure and system that oppresses people. Yeah? On the other hand, you have free flows of desire, you have imagination, fantasy, you have these open spaces, yeah, that create revolutionary opportunities and possibilities. This image seems to me to be very improbable and very not up to date. Why? Because if you look at the reality of contemporary capitalism, it is a flow of desire, it's a flow of money, it's a flow of digital information, flowing beyond any social control, flowing beyond any public and state control all over the world. It's actually a realization of the delusion dream. So I think that if you read Deleuze, it's a description of contemporary financial capitalism in affirmative terms. And if, for example, if you listen today to the Republican Party and nominees like Rick Santorum and many others, you have a feeling, you listen to Foucault, yeah, said, let us end this oppression by public education, let us liberate people from the control, let us set them free, let them realize the desires, let us overcome the status quo, let us come back to the dream of of the open and opportunity and so on. So what for a very long time, under specific conditions of European centralized states and especially France, looked like a good description of capitalism was actually a description of state capitalism that absolutely does not correspond to reality of capitalist development, not corresponded at that time, and absolutely not corresponds after the, obviously not corresponds after the end of the Cold War. So, we are living already in change. Our status quo is change. Yeah? And you can't change a change. we are living already in the flow and so on and so on. So does it mean that something like a transformative action is impossible? I don't think so. I think it is possible, and it is really practiced, but it is practiced in a different way. It is not about overthrowing something, it is about going out of it. Yeah? We have already all the spaces to go out of it. Yeah, how, for example, Eastern European states, is it good or bad, collapsed? Simply because people have withdrawn the support. Yeah? They just went other way. Yeah? The same happens if we analyze what happened in the Arab world and so on and so on. So the real change is not happens today in terms of something like a French October Revolution, but in terms of a withdrawal of support for the acting institutions. And if you withdraw support from the acting institutions, that institution collapse because it can't survive in the competitive reality of contemporary way. So we all are in a kind of competition, and every state, every institution today, looking like, for me, like brides, yeah? Making themselves beautiful for the investment, yeah? Everybody wants to be beautiful for the investment. Yeah, every state, every town, every institution, how wonderful I look, please invest, yeah? This kind of, seduction, yeah, seduction of capital is what the reality of our time. And if things do not look very beautiful, if you contribute to not making them very beautiful, yeah, then the investment don't come and the system collapses. Yeah, that's what we learn in these days. Okay, that is small political comment to my talk, and that's it.